This video is not intended for children under 13 years old. If you are under 13 years old, please do not watch this video as the topics we discuss are meant for those with at least a high school level of education. If you are not 13, you will not understand the scientific topics discussed in this video.
In a previous video, I talked about how as humanity colonizes space, it would be more efficient for it to mine out the contents of a planet to build space stations to live on instead of living on the surfaces of said planets. Yet looking at humanity, we see an entity that is not completely efficient in its actions. So, while planets will be mined up to create space stations in the future, their surfaces might be left intact. There are a few reasons for this, and a few ways that it could be accomplished. So let's take a look, shall we? Part 1. Humans are very sentimental creatures. So much so that trying to get them to go through simple, beneficial changes is met with great resistance. As a result, it would be foolish to think that Earth, the planet that humans have been living on since the beginning of their sentience, would fall victim to being completely mined up. However, as long as Earth is almost completely unchanged by a mining operation, from the perspective of its inhabitants at least, then there will be considerably less backlash as long as there is money to be made. After you go a few hundred feet down, do you really care what's beneath you inside the Earth? As long as it gives off 9.9807 meters per second squared of gravity, provides the planet with a magnetic field, and is not dangerous, I'd imagine that you wouldn't. A similar thing goes for the other objects of the solar system. For any object sufficiently large enough, its gravity well is a hindrance to early mining operations. After all, for early space exploration, we have the entire asteroid belt at our disposal, gravity well free. So, why would we spend the extra energy to pull material off of a planet's surface? Once the asteroid belt runs out of material, it would make sense, but that day will come long after many large objects have colonies on their surfaces. If you have been living on Mars for your whole life, and your family has been there for generations, would you ditch the planet for a space station just because some miners show up saying that the asteroid belt was finished? Of course not. It doesn't matter whether or not Mars has been terraformed, people will want to preserve it. But how can you preserve a planet and gather its resources at the same time? Simple. You mine the interior while leaving the exterior intact. Part 2. If you mine out a planet, you'll be taking all of its gravity with you. Look at the Earth, for instance. Let's say you mined out its interior and left the outside intact for 1 kilometer down. For a very simplified, but not too far off estimate, let's approximate this new hollow Earth as a uniform sphere with a radius of 6,371 kilometers, with a sphere of 6,370 kilometers in radius punched out of it. The resulting mass of this planet will be a little under 0.05% of our Earth. When radius is kept the same, gravity scales proportionally with mass, so this new Earth will only have 0.05% of the gravity it has now, but there are ways to replace this gravity with other material. You don't have to replace material with identical material. You could fill the Earth with a mass of useless waste products equivalent in mass to the material mined. Filling the Earth with garbage, kind of, but the garbage of a space-faring civilization that could mine out a planet would be helium. Pure helium, not anything nasty. Because of nuclear fusion, helium will be a huge waste product in the future. Whether it be in the sun or in any future fusion drives humanity may create, helium will always be a waste product as it is much harder to fuse than hydrogen is. As a result, we could take a ton of this helium waste product and throw it into the Earth as we mine it out. The result would be the surface of Earth remaining intact, sitting over a sphere of highly pressurized helium. This works for the other planets too. You could fill Mars with helium. Venus, even large moons, might want to be mined out and filled with helium. The added benefit here is that for the larger of these objects, you could just fill them with more helium than necessary to boost their gravitational power up to Earth-like levels. Imagine Mars with Earth-like gravity, or Luna. The only downside is that it requires an increase in the pressure that the filler helium is placed under. Helium is not very dense. In fact, it is most commonly known for its lack of density. As a result, it would need to be put under 30,000 atmospheres of pressure to stay inside of Earth. But don't worry about that. You have both a mile of Earth and whatever advanced containment systems the future cooks up to keep this helium from escaping. Also, the immense pressure eliminates the problem of needing to support a shell against gravity. The pressure of the gas does that for you. There is a safety concern with this much pressure, but it's not too pressing. The world record for highest static pressure was 7.6 million atmospheres, hundreds of times higher than our helium would be. Sometimes, things that you would think would be unsafe aren't actually that bad. Part 3. There are two ways to solve the problem of a planet lacking a magnetic field. One involves the filler itself. Helium within the Earth could be placed under so much pressure that its electrons are forced away from its atoms to roam free. If the pressure isn't enough, then heat could be added to help remove the electrons from these atoms. When the electrons leave the atoms of a substance, that substance has become ionized, and the motion of these ions can generate a magnetic field. It's like running electricity through a copper wire. Since these ions would be electrically charged, they would generate a magnetic field. If this doesn't work out for smaller bodies, then large electromagnets could be placed at the first Lagrange points of these objects in order to shield them from the sun. Part 4. There is an alternative filler, but it relies on more theoretical technologies. It is very difficult to push things closer together than we want them to be. This would apply to our helium, but at a certain point of closeness, gravity kicks in and makes it easier. The ultimate end to this trend is when something becomes a black hole. So why not just put an appropriately sized black hole at the center of a shell world? If you could figure out a way to keep the shell of the planet's surface up, then putting a black hole or multiple black holes at its center would work both to generate gravity and to generate energy. Because of Hawking radiation, these tiny black holes at the planet's center would produce a lot of energy. This energy could be directed up through intentionally placed cracks or glass windows in the ground, reflected back down to the ground with orbital mirrors, and used as an artificial sun. This would let the shell world survive independently of a star. Maybe it could even be used for a long, slow version of interstellar travel. One problem would lie in obtaining black holes small enough to fit this purpose. Natural black holes are made of dead stars and are far too massive for planetary scales. A smaller black hole would need to be artificial. There is a theoretical type of black hole called a Kugelblitz black hole. The word Kugelblitz is the German word for ball lightning, and it is an apt name for this concept, because it involves making a black hole out of pure energy. If enough energy in the form of light was crammed together in a tight enough space, then it would become a black hole because E equals mc squared. Kugelblitz black holes could be a major method of energy storage in the future, like a cosmic battery, but they are a topic for another video. Part 5. The shell world model doesn't just need to be something to alter pre-existing celestial bodies. It can also be used to make new ones. If you had the mass requisite to build the shell of a planet and to fill it with waste material, then you could custom make your own worlds. The size and surface gravity of your world would be completely up to you. Especially with the black hole model, you could make incredibly small planets with Earth-like surface gravity. This puts forth shell worlds as a possible alternative to cylindrical habitats, as humans naturally like to live under a sky instead of the ground on the opposite side of a cylinder. But the mass requirement would make them expensive when that mass could be used elsewhere. All in all, the future of the solar system will likely be filled with both shell worlds and cylindrical habitats. Expecting all of humanity to act with one mind would be nonsensical, and because of how large humanity could be if it used the full power of the sun, this effect will be even more pronounced. Using our estimate from a previous video of a sextillion people supported by a Dyson sphere around the sun, we would find every niche filled. Imagine an interest that only 7 people on the entire Earth have today. Such a niche interest would not generate even one business based on it, because 7 people cannot support an industry. If the population of humanity were 1 sextillion, however, then the number of people with that niche interest would rise to 1 trillion people. The industry for this tiny niche would involve a greater number of people than humanity's current population. Using the entire sun's power really would bring about a revolution. Some other weird structures that niche populations might want built in the future are a subject for another video.